Who is clearly facing on an everyday basis are facing, number one, multiple reports about how automation will take away all the jobs, the fact that even if he or she is doing the same role, the demand for skills from the same role is changing on an almost everyday basis, right? So individuals are also under this constant desire to keep pace with their changing job requirements. And even if, like I said, somebody who's continuing in the same role has to look at, how does he or she stay relevant, like I said in the beginning, right? Even organizations or people who want to invest in their learning then have a question, where do I invest time in, right? Because there is also this constant challenge of a new career stream opening almost every day, right? Even if I were to talk the technology or the digital space, starting from a data scientist to an agile to a full stack developer, to a cloud architect, there is a new career stream opening almost every day. So where do you invest time? So, my question to all of you, and Raman, we can start from you, is, given this environment and given this context, two questions. One, what are you hearing and sensing from employees? And I'm saying hearing and sensing in terms of both the stated needs and the unstated needs, the anxiety part of, of the individuals. Two, what are some of the organization level initiatives that your respective organizations taking, to handhold employees and handhold individuals and also your organizations through this space?
Yeah, that's a great question. We can spend the whole day talking about it. But thank you everyone for joining this session after lunch. I know it's always very iffy after lunch, but I hope we'll be able to keep you all awake. Now, going back to your question, I think there are a few things that are playing out, and I think I have a feeling that this might be playing out in most of the companies in where all of you work in. There is a major transformation which is happening. So there is a standard business which is running, the run business which you should do all these years, which is your standard business, and there is a change business which is happening. So people are trying to transform the business while they're trying to keep their existing business going. And that's a very interesting challenge to be with, because the kind of skill sets and the people and the cost metrics for the run business is going to look very different for the way it is going to look for the transformation business. And I think most of us, at least, I know Hewlett Packard Enterprise, we kind of grappled with this in the last few years, saying, how do I run my existing business, keep it still profitable, keep it cost low, keep our people engaged, don't let them attrite, train them and keep them going. And then also, how do we transform? And this transformation, to a certain extent, was also driven by what our customers have been pushing us for, right? The customers are saying, Reliance is one of our largest customers. They are saying, transform, transform, transform. I want to disrupt the market. You are my tech partner. Help me to disrupt the market. Now, so this is an interesting place to be in. So I think we have a different strategy for different places. And the thing that we are trying to build in the company, without getting into what I train for this and what I train for here and there, there is one thing that we're trying to drive in the company, and which we're trying to cultivate, right? We're trying to cultivate four areas, basically. The one thing that we're trying to cultivate is we're trying to make our employees more and more curious and keep adapt of what is changing, how it is changing. So how can I get the curiosity bug in the company, so in the people? So that's one thing that we try to create. The second thing that we're trying to create is, while we are driving this curiosity bug, how can we make it inclusive across the whole company? Can we make everyone feel that they need to ride this curiosity bug? And how do we, because if they're not curious, they'll not learn. If they don't learn, they will not help me to transform. If they don't help me to transform, I don't survive as a company. So it kind of goes that way. So we're trying to say, how can we make this curiosity bug an inclusive bug? And we're trying to do a few things around that. The other thing that we are trying to cultivate, and this we are doing through our different tools and applications and learning methods that we're using, is how is it that we can make this, support these two areas by resourcefulness. How resourceful are you? How can we take resources that are available as a company, learning resources, knowledge resources? We're trying to create a resourcefulness, cultivate a resourcefulness, kind of a theme in the company. And the fourth thing, which is extremely important, is that when we're doing this change of how we used to train in the past and develop people in the past and how we're going to do it today and tomorrow, we are trying to cultivate a feeling of persistence in the mind of the people. Because if you cannot cultivate that, we will not be able to make the changes. And I think that's a very important thing for us, saying that how can we have a persistent set of people who will understand that change is here to stay, and you need to be persistently changing yourself and therefore be curious, be resourceful, and be inclusive in the way you go around. So we're trying to build those areas in the whole approach that we're trying to get in.
Sure. Okay.
Anuj, you want to take it?
Sure. So Vikram, there were two parts of the question.
Bimal. Right?
First part was about what is the sense you're getting from the employees in the organization in this increasingly connected and disrupted world. There is a mixed bag of emotions all around. There is unrest, there is excitement, there is fear about what's going to happen, right? We are living in the world where something gets novel in the morning becomes obsolete by the evening, right? Education used to be a tailgate for careers a couple of years back. Today it's not. Today careers are actually the experience which define what you're going to achieve at the end of it. Shelf life of skills is reducing day by day. I think, if I am not wrong, the last I read about 2-3 months ago, half life of a skill has reduced to less than 5 years. What we are teaching today in universities, colleges, once the kids come out and start their careers, what they've learned is actually irrelevant. Now, what do you do? Are we prepared for that? And that's the dilemma which is, you know, being faced everywhere. This year's World Economic Forum, there was a 3-hour debate with the world leaders about how we going to handle this, because suddenly there's an upsurge of new belt of skills, which was never there. And I would like to take a different stance to the question that you posed, which is technology disruption never eats away jobs. It in fact creates more opportunities for jobs. And history has proved it time and again. When computers came into being, there was a lot of shebang around, okay, we're going to lose our jobs, automation is going to happen, people will become irrelevant. Did that happen? The answer is no. It actually created more opportunities for people to fall into multiple different career paths, right? And I think we need to learn from history and walk the same path right now, in the sense that from a standpoint of learning, you know, there was an author I'm reminded of, his name is William Edward Deming. And he quoted something some 30, 40 years ago. Learning is not compulsory. So is survival. Choice is ours. So do you want to ride the tide or get swooned away by that is a choice that each and every one of us have to look at now. Having said that, let's look at the brass tacks of what we, you know, we're talking about employees. Let's change the role. Let's look at us as learners, let's look at us as people. We are also in the same bell, we are not, you know, from the different standpoint. That fear is in me as well. How do I stay relevant in today's increasingly connected, disrupted world? What do I do? And that brings a radical shift in the thought process. From being the traditional learning departments who were supposed to provide learning to people and, you know, guide them, you need to walk on this XYZ golden path, it's the role has changed. The role now is, how do I empower? How do I enable? And third, how do I support? And not just bare bones learning via programs or the, you know, geek words, gamification, simulation. No, those are all tenets, right? The fact is, how do I create an environment that promotes learning on demand and learning all the time? Why do we want to take away time from learning? Whereas every research report across the last 120 years has proved that 90% of learning happens on the job. It does not happen in the traditional ways, right? We are living in an era where we have multiple generation workforces in our organizations. Can we look at ways and means to address each one of their interests by being a catalyst, not being a creator? How I learn is something I decide, not somebody else. Can I provision that in an employee's daily work life, every single hour of that? Can I look at providing those different experiences and not just look at silo-wise career paths, but looking at multi-generation or multi-varied career paths? It's all about how do you leverage people, process, technology, and weave around the circle of engagement around it. And that's what we at Reliance are trying to do, in a sense that there are multiple different tenets of this. It's not a, it's a daunting task. One is making people aware what they need to know at a bare bones level, and then coming back and saying, you know what, you decide. Let us not decide sitting in one silo-wise cabin in, as HR fraternity to decide what people need to know. Let them decide what they want to do. And why restrict the learning only to the remits of the organization? Why aren't open to the entire world? So chaos is an opportunity as well. How do you leverage the opportunities, what we're trying to do over there, by multiple different interventions, multiple different initiatives of giving, number one, asset empowerment, leveraging technology so we can embed learning directly in people's day-to-day processes and directly linking it to performance, not just silo-ized. And number three, which is the most important, is providing a culture which is happy for people to fail. Fail fast and learn. If you don't fail, you don't learn. That's the most important element. Which
we'll come to the culture part in any case in the last.
Over to you.
All right, so quite frankly, I'm feeling overwhelmed being sandwiched between two such illustrious speakers. I don't have research reports to talk from, but I will draw analogies from anecdotes, and I will take it closer to family. So it's interesting, my daughter, who's now 20 plus years and was wanting to study medicine since she was perhaps in her sixth grade. And when she went and talked to people, and when we went and talked to people about her career choice that she wants to study medicine, you will be surprised that there were a lot of senior doctors who asked her this, that this is a profession of lifelong learning. Do you really want to get into this? Right? And even today, when she is undergoing her education, and when somebody says, so what is your daughter doing? Somebody new meets me across the street and says, what's your child doing? And I say, she's studying medicine or wants to study medicine. Oh man, that's a lifelong pursuit. Right? The reason I bring that analogy is that today's world is identical. There is no profession that can escape that paradigm that learning is lifelong. So the sooner we realize it, and the sooner we help our employees realize that, it's better for everyone. The reason I also mention this is because Bimal talked about a dichotomy at the start of the conversation. And he mentioned about people saying that I would stay longer if somebody invested in my career, and organizations wondering where to find time and where to make time for people to learn. Right? Guess what's been my biggest pain point in the organization? When people say that, okay, are you investing in my career? What's the most abused tool in HR fraternity, which you will find is thrown at every problem, but is the most underutilized tool by the organization? Any guesses? IDP, Individual Development Plan. Everybody writes it, nobody follows it. Every HR person will say that for my top talent, I will ensure IDPs are prepared in the organization. At the end of the year, ask him how many IDPs actually got written. The statistic would invariably be south of 50%. And ask how many actually got implemented. The number would fall by half or perhaps more. Okay. So therefore, the challenge essentially is, how do you cultivate this culture of continuous learning? And if it can happen in one profession, I'm sure it can be learned and applied and replicated in another profession. The other interesting facet that Anuj touched upon was multi-generational workforce. Reality is that if you look around, since the time of industrial revolution, workforces have always been multi-generational. if your age of entry is going to be 22, 25, and if your age of exit is going to be 60, there will always be a multi-generational workforce. So in my belief, honestly, this is a little overrated. And here again, I'll bring you to a very interesting anecdote which I saw in my own family. My father-in-law, interestingly, he's retired from one of the PSUs, and he somehow every few months believes that he's sick and wants to go to the doctor. Okay, it happens with a lot of old people. So trust me, you all of us will reach that stage. And when he wants to go to a hospital, the biggest thing he has to ask anybody is, who's the senior most doctor? And his definition of senior most doctor is that unless that man has a full head of gray hair, that guy is not the senior most doctor. Okay. It was so hilarious that once I went with him to meet, and he said, can I meet the head of department? And can I meet the senior most doctor? That gentleman said, sir, with all due respect, I'm the senior most doctor. And I'm the HOD. And the senior most person in this discipline is no more than 35 years of age, because this discipline itself within medicine 35 years or less than 35 years old. Ab aap kar lijiye aapko jisse baat karni. He had no choice but to deal with that man. Okay. So the reason I'm trying to draw these parallels from real life is because these things are a reality. I think the reason, or let me back up, the sooner we make our people understand that and embrace that reality, it is better for all of us. Yes, there will always be challenges. People will always come and tell you that I'm apprehensive of something, and there is a change happening. People have always been apprehensive of change. Okay? If that's the only door to go out of this hall, and suddenly we say that we will open this door and you have to go out, everybody will say, why? It's natural. Okay? So this happens all the time. So we've got to find a way to deal with that. And that's a continuous process, because change has been happening. It is just that the pace of change has accelerated. So deal with an accelerated pace of change. And the only thing that happens in an accelerated pace of change is that your speed of response becomes shorter and shorter. Right? So all of us have played video games. Right? So if you play a video game in which there is a fast moving car, your space in terms of your maneuverability reduces that much more. So you've got to navigate that much faster. That's about it. All right? So nothing's changed. So your tools are there. The tools haven't changed if you look at it. The sooner that you apply them, the faster that you can get over it. And the big thing that you'll have to decide is, what is my exit point and how soon do I move away from my exit point? How soon do I cut my losses, or how long do I stay invested in something? That's the only thing that's changing in my perspective. And that's where I would leave this discussion and say, let's move to the other aspect.
So let me start with Anuj, the point that you made, from an employee perspective, and also from an employer perspective, these are complex conversations. Like you said, there are a lot of emotions involved in these conversations. Right? There's a lot of insecurities, a lot of anxieties, right? But eventually, all of those emotional conversations, and it could be coming from any factor, comparisons, anxiety, whatever. Eventually, that conversation has to get structured into an IDP in some sense, right? A plan for this individual, which gives him some kind of concrete learning path in some sense. But at the same point of time, that path has to tie in with the organizational needs. Right? So there is this factor of emotions, organization requirement, individual requirement, and then a learning path and a learning journey through for the employee. Right? Now, in this context, okay, if we were to come to specifics, what, for the benefit of audience, are there specific things that you've seen, you've done at Reliance, or Reliance as an organization, in doing in terms of using specific tools or methodologies or platforms or whatever, in terms of then, how do you convert this conversation into a learning map for the organization?
That's a very tough question. I'll try and attempt to answer, and I might not have the exact answer to that. Sure. So you touched upon multiple elements in that question. I have a little different point of view on the terminology called IDP. And my colleague who has said, actually spilled the beans saying that, you know what, in reality, less than 25% of IDPs really get materialized or really get followed. The question to answer, ask is why?
Yeah.
Is it just a tick in the box? Why don't people follow their IDPs? The answer to that is because I haven't bought into that. It's somebody else telling me what I need to do. And I have seen that in the last 19 years of my professional experience that never works. A stick never works. You can never force an individual to learn. Unless my learning is tied to a purpose or linked to my career, I will never invest my time. At the max, you can bring a horse to the well. You cannot force the horse to drink. You just cannot. Now, the dilemma over there is, there are my personal development needs, and then there is an organizational need for me to develop. Somewhere down the line, the HR or the learning catalysts, per se, have to balance that specific need. And we have tried to take certain baby steps in that direction. As I mentioned in my last, answer, it's all about, which I call PPTE, People, Process, Technology, and Engagement. You can't deliver learning. You cannot enforce learning. You can only empower people. You can enable an environment. And you can provision access. And you can provision experience. We can only provision those things. Now, whether the person or the individual walks on that path is his own choice. You can encourage using various tools or techniques. You can have rewards. You can have recognitions, but you cannot force somebody to learn.
Sure.
Unless that particular thing is, as I said again, tied to a purpose or tied to what I need. Now, to do that, certain elements which we have incorporated and which we are in a journey of a platform ecosystem is provisioning learning on demand, number one. An average employee spends about 24 minutes in a week to learn. And that's not classroom, unfortunately. Or in fact, fortunately. That is by way of talking to other people, Googling, YouTubing, or for that matter of fact, trying something out, failing, and then learning by himself. That's what we're trying to do. Using technology has led to provision those elements, learning beyond the realm of the organization, number one. Number two is unrestrained access to content. So content that's not just in the remits of the organization, but more which is even on Google or other different, whether it's a MOOC or a different element of it. Third is leveraging analytics and feeding back to users certain things they might want to do. Just like Amazon does today, right? They would leverage a machine learning algorithm. You bought this, people like you also bought this.
Yeah.
Right? Collaborative filtering, multi-arm banded stuff, which happens on most of the platforms like Facebook or WhatsApp, using technology to provision those things, looking at clickstream analytics, figuring out what people are really learning. Is it really tied back to their careers, or are they interested in looking at different elements of learning and recommending those things to them, encouraging them with those elements. Third element is what they're learning. Is there a career path? Not a linear one, but a more, multi-dimensional career paths. Can a person do that? Provisioning those elements we're trying to do from an org perspective. There are always things which will be an outlier. What I'm doing is not befitting the realm of the organization. Do I want to stop it? The answer is no. And why should I stop it?
Sure.
That's what we're trying to do.
Sure. Ajay, I'll take a clue from your earlier answer and what Anu just said. That in many cases, the individual here does not buy into the IDP. My question to you is, has the organization bought into the IDP, or IDP when it was created was also the tick in the box for the organization because they wanted to handle that transaction at that point of time ki boss isko bhi settle karo, right? Just make him settle, right? So how does that part play out, right? And sorry, and just to complete, and you know, some of the words that Anuj said in terms of you know, organization says, boss, my role is to enable, give you access, content. So my job is done, and I have created an IDP, and I have given you all the tools and freedom, etc., etc., to learn. Now the ball is in your court.
Okay. I think somewhere my mention about IDP got misconstrued as I am sitting here writing IDPs for 14,500 people. Humanly impossible. If in my organization, my HR to FTE ratio, which I'm told is reasonably liberal, is 1:200 people, it is humanly impossible for any HR person, or for that matter, line manager who has about 7 to 8 people reporting to him, or perhaps more in some cases, it is humanly impossible for somebody to write those IDPs. So IDP at the end of the day is a flexible tool in the hands of employee. And you tell the employee that you are encouraged to create your own IDP. You are never giving him a prescriptive IDP, because prescriptive IDPs stopped working when they were invented, leave alone in today's day and age. And to that extent, I would agree with Anuj and say that you can't write somebody's career path and career destiny in that sense. And people shape their careers in their own ways. That being said, IDPs are still underutilized because people don't plan their careers the way you may think that they ought to plan. And each person's way of planning their career is very different because their circumstances could be different, their career narrative could be different, they could be influenced by different people. So that individual journey can be very different for each person. So one should not be attempting writing IDPs for people. And to that extent, the organization provides opportunities for people to learn and tools for people to learn so that they learn what is relevant for your organization. And you essentially tell them through your mechanisms of either rewarding them or appraising them or whatever you may do, and in terms of providing them career opportunities, that this is relevant for the organization. And there is a constant communication, and we encourage our managers, so to say, to continuously engage in career conversations. So career conversations, or perhaps stay interviews in our organization, are a lot more preferred tool today than IDP, so to say. The other thing that we've done and we've found more success with is succession planning, because that is where the organization has a role to play. And I think it is for the organization to ensure business continuity through succession planning. So you've got to do succession planning not with the aim of career planning for individuals, but for protecting the interest of the organization by saying, I will ensure business continuity. And then from there, if you encourage managers to have career conversations with people that these are the kind of roles that are available in the organization, what kind of roles would you be interested in at what point in time, you then start putting all that together, and over a period of time, it becomes a comprehensive document. So it's not a one-day affair that you do succession planning. It's not a one-off event that you do. It is something that you have to continuously do for that process to mature. And you have to continuously monitor the health of that process by saying what are the outcomes that you're targeting through that. So it's never an IDP one-off kind of a thing which yields results for you. So you have to continuously look at what are the outcomes that you want and what processes do you want. IDP is just an enabler in the whole process.
So Raman, you know, on the last point, and what is clearly coming out from both Ajay and Anuj's comment is that while organization will play this role of a facilitator, you know, enablement, etc., but eventually a large part of career planning, learning, the responsibilities is of the individual, of the employee, right? and like I said, the organization will enable, give all the tools, access, etc., etc. But now, given that the large part of responsibility is on the individual, but there is also this very big demand on organizations to eventually measure the impact of investments that they are making. So you're not controlling the outcome to some extent because that is up to the individual, but you are the talent development head is being questioned for the investments that he or she is seeking towards talent development. And there also the measurement in which a talent development professional might be doing in terms of measuring effectiveness versus the way the CEO might be measuring the effectiveness, right, would be very different, right? So how do you manage this part of the equation?
Okay, so I'm going to say something slightly provocative over here.
Sure.
How many people in this room are non-HR folks? Okay, so that's better. At least I was hoping there'll be some people because what I'm going to say here might make me slightly unpopular among the HR fraternity. Okay, so pardon me for that. I think the classical way of how talent development teams have worked in the past, which worked very well for the run business, as I said earlier, is not going to be the classical way that talent development is going to work in the change and the growth business. And this talent development is not going to be a single one box player anymore. I think I'm convinced, and I know that is happening, is going to be three in a box player. And the three in the box is the CEO, if we have a chief strategy officer, and the talent guy. I don't know what he's going to be called. I don't think talent developer is the right name to call. But your talent is your to the point that all of you made, is a business enabler, and it is going to grow your business. So if it's not three in a box, and if it is going out and saying, hey, give me money because I want to buy some total LMS, commercial for you, okay, give me some money on that. So you got to buy that, then you'll never get it. Till the time it comes from the, it has to be a three in a box approach, and I think that's going to be critical. And we have done a few things, but maybe because of interest of time, we'll let that pass. But I strongly feel it's three in a box.
Sure. And let me start with you this time again. So well, you can create IDPs, enable, et cetera, measure, define outcomes, three in a box. How do you ensure that all the effort that is done today also becomes a culture in the organization? It is sustained over a very period of time. And when I'm saying culture, it also means that your immediate demand of skills which are required for managing today's projects are taken care of. But it also means that your demands that are going to come 3 years, 2 years from today, that is, how do you balance that equation? Second part is I'm going back to the initial problem that I also stated from an organization perspective, that clearly the CEOs or the talent development heads are saying that people don't make time. Despite doing all the enablement, people don't make time to learn. So how do you reduce this friction? I mean, eventually, if you have to make this as a culture, one, the friction has to go out, right? Two, you have to marry from a CEO perspective, who's a part, important part of the box, you have to marry today's immediate project requirements to the future skills. How do you make that, how do you make this as a culture?
Okay, so that's a very deep question. So I have a couple of ways of, we basically look at it as the way, how do we do an acid test for culture, right? Unless you do the acid test, you don't know what the gaps are. So, and there are a few questions that we provoke and we ask among leaders and our people. And when I say people, I don't only mean employees, but leadership team, HR teams, business teams, and stuff like that. And the question that I ask is that, does the leadership reinforce the need to learn? Is it only HR who is saying learn, learn, learn? Or is the leadership talking about learning? Okay. Now, the second question is, if the answer is yes, then my second question is that, as a leadership team and as experts in the organization, are you spending enough time to teach people? And there are teachable moments, right? It doesn't always need to be a classroom training or stuff like that. But the second acid test is that, are you really spending time to impart knowledge, skills, experience to your team members? So that is the second question that I ask as the acid test. The third question, which is critical, and we normally get an answer is yes, but it's not really yes, because people struggle to do it, is that, as an organization, are we openly sharing information about what is going on? Do we know what challenges we have as a company? And this is where we want to go. This is how the path looks like. And to go that path, I need you. You need me. So that knowledge has to be shared, information to be shared very openly. And the last one about how I look at the asset test is that faced with a challenge or a situation or a problem is the large part of the organization asking not sitting back and say, hey, I don't know how to deal with it, or what the heck, someone tell me. But instead the question is that, what might we do? If we don't ask that question, what might we do in the culture, you'll never have a culture organization, learning culture to support the growth and the development and the transformation. So that would be my look at how do you do the acid test of culture.
Sure. So Ajay Anuj, last question to you guys, quick comment before we open it to the audience. Are managers the missing link?
Okay, I'll take that. Since I'm holding the mic, it'll save us time. The way we've done that in the organization, yeah, your point is right. Our managers the missing link. The only thing I would say to that extent is we've driven this as a culture in our organization by introducing what we call as behaviors, right? So we are an organization that still subscribes to the famous 9-block for assessment. And behaviors are an integral part of our assessment. And no, we are not jettisoning the performance appraisal system. We happily subscribe to it. And one of the critical behaviors there is become your best. And everyone is expected to be rated on it by the manager. And similarly, there is a behavior for the managers to demonstrate that how do you enable your teams to become better. So managers get rated on it, employees get rated on it. That's how we've made it exemplary for both to demonstrate that kind of a behavior. And that's how we are driving the culture in our organization. And as I said, the key piece in our organization is you drive your own career. So therefore, look at those behaviors, look at the resources available to you, take charge of your destiny. And that's what brings about the sustainable change. As long as you have people empowered, they will do the right thing.
Anuj, any quick point to add on the manager piece?
I think I agree with what Ajay said. Just to one-liner saying that there are two ways to look at culture building, what you asked, and is manager the missing link? The only one answer to that is that prove yourself and then ask for a chance, or the other way is ask for a chance and then prove yourself. That choice is given to the employee. Now you have the dice in front of you. You want to roll it or keep staring at it? No one's going to come and feed you the food. The plate is in front of you. Pick it up. We will give you an environment. We'll give you all the cutlery. We'll give you the washing bowl as well. The fact is, do you make the most of the opportunity?
Sure. So on that note, we've enabled the audience. Hopefully, we've enabled the audience. We've given you all the cutlery, et cetera, et cetera. So I'm not going to attempt to summarize anything here. Like we said, it's a very diverse topic, and happy to have a great panel who've shared, like we said, given you the entire buffet. Please take what you feel like, but we're happy to take questions for the panel now. Are we displaying? So we did a poll on the app as well. Are we displaying the results first to begin with? Can the audience read this? Because we are sitting in front of their screens. Yeah, or do we do this after the question? Maybe you can take the quick question and then audience can see this later. Start. I saw one hand going. Yeah, please.
Hi everyone. So basically I wanted to concentrate on two words here.
To which
no panelists? Not the panelists, is the question.
Sure.
The word assessment and grow your passion. So I basically wanted to know, does assessment play as a positive or a negative reinforcer in growing a passion? And second, if it's a positive reinforcer, what role will organization play in making sure that it increases, given that most of the onus is on the employee?
Yeah, Roman?
I'll take that if you don't mind. So, let me draw an analogy. Let's say four of us go to watch a movie. It's the same movie theater, same actor, same popcorn, same ice cream, right? the experience each one of us has is very different. And that's the way you look at assessments. It's the way you position that, all right? The way you position assessments, if I am evaluating an employee, it automatically invokes fear. I am being assessed. Rather, I position it in a way, this is summative in nature. This assessment is for you to figure out what you know and what you want to know, and that's going to create a personalized learning path for you that you drive yourself. Now, what you're doing is you're handing over the reins to the employee. So it's the way how you position things. The moment you talk about evaluations and all those things, the negative connotation starts coming in. Having said that, in certain parts of businesses, you would have to do that. When you have certain asset-facing roles or business-critical roles where it could lead to an accident or other things, you would have to certify those things. It's a fine balance you need to play in those assessments, and they do bring in a lot of importance in terms of reinforcement.
Raman, you had a point?
No, I just got another question.
Yeah? Okay.
I think Anuj said it all. My own experience with assessments is that no matter how you position them, it scares people. We have something called as 360 assessment. For the longest period in our time, it is one of the most underutilized tool. Less than 1% people subscribe to it. Although it is paid for by the organization, there are coaches available in the organization. Less than 1% people go and willfully subscribe to it. Okay, so assessments, no matter how you position them, it scares people. But they are essential. It's an essential pill that sometimes you need to administer, as Anuj rightly said. And when you have to do it, then do it with a humane face.
Go ahead.
Raman, you very nicely, you know, in your first part of the speech, you introduced the word curiosity. Can we put that part in a learning system where, you know, as a skill, in the training sessions when we go through this assessment, you have to go your communication skills and presentation skills. Can we include something like critical thinking? You know, this is a skill. A philosopher once said, you have to practice thinking. So that's my question. Can that be added?
You know, I think human beings by nature is curious. Okay, so I don't know. I'm sure you have a smartphone with you, right? And the amount of time I don't know how much time you spend on the smartphone. I spend horrendous amount of time. But if you notice that you go from one place to another site to on site because you're curious to know what it is. If you open up a news page, you see something, you click on it, you go somewhere. So I believe, this is my belief, that human beings are curious by nature. We need to encourage that curiosity and not do something which is detrimental to it. So if you had the smartphone and you had the headline, and if you clicked on it and couldn't go to the next page, you'll be furious and frustrated. Okay. So if our learning systems did the same thing, so to kind of do something and then don't follow up on the curiosity, you don't put the, as I said, it's a culture, it's something that you got to build in the DNA. So that's what you do. I think human beings, as I said, is curious.
Sure. Do we have time for one question?
Last question. So my question is also to you, Raman. You mentioned that you're creating, to build a culture for learning, you have to create teaching moments within the organization. And that's something that, you know, we specifically stress on when it comes to managers, you know, coaching, developing people. So what would you recommend be, what do you do in your organization to create such moments?
So interestingly, it was around 3 years back. It was kind of more about on the board, in the writing board, that we need to do this. And interestingly, it started off with in one of our, we normally do this all employees meet. It started off in an all employees meet where our CEO at that time was someone called Meg Whitman. Meg Whitman did something called she said that as a learning moment. She explained in front of, with that time we had 300,000 people across the globe. In an all employee meet, she said, how we lost our client. Okay, this is sharing of information, right? She shared it out. Then she shared what we did wrong, not blaming anyone, but what we did wrong to lose that client. It's done over 2 minutes. What we did wrong to lose that client. What we will do differently that we don't lose that client again. So this is a learning moment example. And believe me, this had such a big effect. You know, and basically the message that she was trying to pass is, you know, when there's a client problem, run to the fire, don't sit on it, don't hope it'll go away. That was the message. Now, running to the fire, everyone talks about it, but we find it difficult to relate to. So now what happens is that, and start there, then other managers did this, other leaders did this. So we are now getting into a situation where you talk about a failure or a situation, failure and success both, about what happened, and then someone's making an emergency call there, don't worry. So and then you kind of do that, and you explain it. And we try to do it in 2-3 minutes, and it is working phenomenal. Try it out. Sharing of information, and share a real life experience and what you learned from it. It works phenomenal.
Cool. So thank you very much for joining us for this panel. Like I said, we're not going to try summarize it, please. But I hope it, the session added value to all of you. Thank you very much. Thank you.